So I am Marie-Paul Cany. I'm a professor at Grenoble Institute of Technology, INPG. And I'm also the head of a research team at INRIA, an institute of research in computer science. And so my talk will be very different. It's from computer science. I'll try to explain you what you could get by trying to model the shapes you imagine in 3D and model them and model their motion. So from the start of maybe humanity, humans have tried to express the shape they see or the shape they imagine. And if you invent or imagine a song or music, you can express it by singing. But if you imagine a shape in motion, you need a support to express it, and you need a tool to express it. And so people have used as support, for instance, caves. They have started to draw, they have started to sculpt, and it's very difficult to express shapes in motion by sketching and sculpting, because a 3D shape, you need many sketches maybe to see it from different angles. And if there is a motion, a story, an animation, you need many different sketches. And if you want to express motion through sculpting, it's even more difficult, because you can only sculpt static shapes and you can only imagine motion because of disequilibrium here. And expressing this shape in motion is not only useful for fun, it's also useful for trying to understand what you see and trying to invent new things. And these are examples from Leonardo da Vinci. And what he did is he was trying to understand how the branching systems in trees were working. And he used sketches to try to understand this. And here he was inventing a flying object. And really, the fact that you interact with this graphical representation is very important to be able to refine and to express what you have in mind. It has even been proved by scientists of cognitive sciences that graphical designs have to be seen as cognitive tools enhancing and extending our brains. We would not be able to understand and invent if we don't have this visual graphical representation. So nowadays, people have more often a digital table in their pocket than a piece of clay. And some of them has more often a digital table even than paper and pen. So of course the question is, could digital media could be directly used by humans, by any user, but also by scientists, to express the shapes and the shapes in motion they have in mind? With this digital media, they could draw, but not only draw in 2D, they could draw in 3D, as in the example of modeling the head at the right. They could also sculpt, but not only sculpt static shapes. We could think of sculpting motion. What would be sculpting motion? This doesn't exist in the physical world. This could exist with the digital media. And of course, we can get rid of constraints. We don't have any more constraints with the size of support or the size of our fingers or size of tool, because we can always zoom in. And then we can make ourselves as small as we want compared to what we are modeling. We can undo, redo, we can copy-paste. So really the question is, can we do better than paper and pen to design new content to express the shapes, the imaginary shapes that we have in mind? And the answer, the field I belong to, is computer graphics. So computer graphics, first of all, is not at all image processing or imagery, because we don't start with an image. The image is the output. We start from a mathematical model of a 3D shape, maybe 3D shape in motion, and the goal is to create an image, and this is this visual representation I was talking about. And to create this image, we use three steps. The first one is geometric modeling. We model the 3D geometry using mathematical representations. Then we animate this geometry. For instance, here there is a virtual sea. Here we could animate the waves, etc. And then the rendering is the fact that we try to compute what a camera, what an eye would see, what we should put in each pixel of an image if we simulate this virtual scene with lights and with material, which image we should put. And so how do we build large the scene? How can we express what we have in mind using computer graphics? So there was a huge progress in the last few years in data reconstruction. And of course, we can try to capture what exists in the real world. This is exactly like in the last talk when there was this with this camera, you could capture, for instance, the animation of the little cells that were shown. You can also capture with a set of camera a human motion and convert it into a virtual human. You can capture like here architectural models and try to from the set of points from a 3D scanner, then try to model it with the nicer primitives. But the problem with this is that, of course, we cannot capture everything. And our goal would be to be able also to express things that does not exist or do not exist yet, things that we imagine, that we invent, or the model we have of the real world, not all the complexity of a sample of the real world, but the model we think about, to be able to refine it and think about it. So then reconstruction will not be sufficient to match these goals. There is another way to do things, is procedural generation. For instance, if I want to model the virtual world on the right, what I can do is have a computer generate it from me. But for this, I need to specify rules. So these rules would be the rules of formation of trees, of formation of forest, the rules of like fractals for generating the terrain. So here, even the little village you can see was generated with rules, modeling the fact that how human will build a new house near the existing houses, how roads are built where there are houses, and so on. We iterate, and we can even model the formation of this little village. Here, the control is totally indirect because we interact with this content which is created by tuning the parameters of all these rules, and then we run a simulation. And so modeling a specific content is done through lots of trials and errors. And efficiency of the model is, of course, essential, because if you set up these rules, you put parameters, you apply, push a button, and then you wait for 1 week, you will not be able to model what you want. So you need then to do this really with interactive model. And for more than 10 years, I have worked in trying to apply this procedural generation and be able to simulate nature. So these are examples of objects that were modeled in my research groups, from a virtual ocean to clouds to hair to organs inside the human body. And here, when you try to model through these rules and procedurals model natural shapes and phenomena, the main problem is handling complexity. There is a complexity of shapes, for instance, for the clouds, complexity of motion, how ocean waves will roll, and how they will have lots of particles, and so on. There are a number of elements, for instance, for all this hair interacting together. And of course, other sciences have studied this phenomena for several hundreds of years. So we collaborate with other sciences, but we take care of the specific needs of computer graphics, where what we need is visual realism, because what we want is this visual interaction with the content we create. So what is important is that we express what we imagine, not that it exactly simulates a specific existing ocean, for instance. There is speed, which is a very important thing. As I said, we are modeling through trial and error. And we want some intuitive control so that a user, through these rules, is able to control the content. So I just briefly give you a few examples. In fact, to be able to model these natural phenomena, we invented a specific methodology, which I called layered models. This is a very simple example, very old. This is the first natural scene we modeled in my group, which was a lava flow. This is a simple example to understand the notion of layered model. If I want to model a lava flow, I will try to decompose the problem, this is a real lava flow on the top, into a series of sub-phenomena. And this lava flow first should find a trajectory along the slopes of a volcano, as here. And then also, it should have a surface. And then the surface can split into pieces. If there is a rock, for instance, the flow would split into two pieces. And it should have a specific visual aspect, which is a texture of the lava, which should be quite smooth and very yellow on the top, but become more and more rugged at the bottom while it is cooling down. And so the idea is that for each of these subphenomena, you find the best representation, you model them by a different submodel, and we couple these submodels so that they work together and they are in turn simulated during the simulation. So for instance, in the lava flow, we have three submodels, a set of interactive particles that simulate also the changes of temperature, which is thrown on the volcano, are in collision and so on. Then an implicit surface that codes these particles. And then we put a texture on top, which depends on the heat of the particles. And this is how we can very efficiently get this animation of a lava flow. And this, all the submodels, they can be fixed, but they can also be dynamically changed and adapt to the needs. I will show it in another example. The example of this prairie, where you can explore this prairie in real time. And there was a stone rolling in the prairie. And here we can see the pieces of grass that were just laid down by the stone, and slowly they are coming back up. So if I want to animate this prairie in real time, what I need is that in front of me, there is always 3D blades of grass. But for the part of the grass which is farther away, maybe only like texture, which is like grass painted into a transparent polygon, can be sufficient. And I need this because else there will be too many blades of grass to display. And then very far away, there will be only a single texture. So in this animation, for instance, what you see is of a transition between all this level of detail. So grass, which is at the which is far away, it's just texture which is painted. But while we advance and we explore this prairie, this grass that was a texture becomes a set of 3D blades of grass. So there is a transition. It's like in theater when you have how do you say it? It's a bit fake, but you see, this is a way we can handle this complexity. Another example is I want to have virtual hair. And here we have a comparison between our virtual hair model, we'll see in slow motion, and a real person. This is really to show how much our model is accurate. Here, the idea is that you only keep the degrees of freedom you need for your model. So you model, you simulate Gauss strands, then we handle collisions at the level of hair wisps, and then we add more geometric strands within the hair wisps, and you see here how it works. And the last example is the layered model for clothes. Here the idea is that in real time we can have a coarse physically based simulation. We detect the places where the cloth has compressed. For instance, here in this region, the cloth is completely compressed. And in this region, we will add folds that are along the lines, the compression lines that are computed from the compression field. So we use implicit surfaces to add these folds, which add all the little details. This means that we have something which is plausible, easier to tune parameters, and that can be real time and represent what we imagine in real time. Of course, this can also be applied. I took this example because this is a bit closer to biology. This can be also applied to animated anatomy. So here we are animating in real time a part of human anatomy where you have all the tissues that are deformable, but the bones are still completely rigid inside. So all this is very nice. Okay, I can animate this natural phenomena. But this is not sufficient in practice because remains the problem, how do I create this content? Okay, we can model through rules, but we only get indirect control. If I want to model something precise, if I'm a film director doing Avatar, for instance, I want to model the natural thing scenes in the film, applying on a button and with rules will not be sufficient. So in fact, it's not used in practice. What people are doing in practice is that they are still modeling in most cases. We have specialized computer artists who work for 5 years in specialized school to learn to use these complex modeling systems with lots of menus and buttons, and they get no help for realism from this system. So in my research, what I try to do is to enable a creation using a kind of flow in digital creation, and this is what I call expressive modeling. Here you have two examples of expressive modeling. On the left, you have a sketch-based modeling system where anybody, even a child, can model something in 3D just by sketching in 2D. And this is just each time the person is sketching a silhouette, we just create a 3D model, which is the simplest model that matches and fits this silhouette. And all these different details are progressively blended together. On the right, you see a system we did for modeling virtual clay with a computer. Sorry, it just stopped. And an interface we designed to be able to control in real time a virtual hand modeling a virtual clay. So these are sketching and sculpting are examples of modeling with a flow. Then you are completely with your model. You are not with menus, buttons, and anybody can be able to model. And the subject of my research now is that can we enable such flow for complex shapes? On the top, you have a surface which is a developable surface. Can we model it through sketching? Can we sculpt a mountain? By here, you draw a silhouette and it deforms a mountain. And there is something which is interesting, is shape transfer. This is intelligent copy-paste. So here on the right, you see the example where we have modeled clothes for a virtual character, and we can copy-paste this clothing to other character, but it deforms automatically, staying developable, keeping the same design. So this is exactly the kind of thing we want. And so I will just give three more examples for these three interaction modes: sketching, copy-pasting, transfer, and sculpting. So sketch-based modeling, let us take a biological example, the example of a tree. Okay, if you want to model a tree, if you are using this standard interfaces I was talking about, then you would need to model individually each branch, each leaf. It would take forever. So, of course, the artist wants and needs to control the specific shape of a specific tree. But it needs to take care of biological and statistical laws. And so our inspiration is how artists do create trees. When artists create trees, very often they will sketch the overall shape, and then they will progressively refine it in some regions. And even if they don't put the details everywhere, we imagine that the details they have drawn in some regions are the same everywhere. So the idea to be able to model 3D trees in real time is to combine multi-resolution sketches with procedural generation. And we do it in the following way. The user will sketch the silhouette of a tree. From this silhouette, the system will automatically create the little branches that correspond to this silhouette, and will automatically create some construction line, enabling the user to zoom on one of these construction lines to give some more detail. Again, it creates all the branches, and the user can do that until the user defines a leaf. And when the user zooms out and go back, all what he has created is duplicated in 3D, and then is also duplicated to the other branches. So you have a tree that respects the drawing, and which is created in real time. I show you a little video just to illustrate this concept. So this is here applied to trees, because we need trees for a virtual environment, but this could be applied to any model you have in mind, this is models which are self-similar at different scales. So they have statistical properties as well, and we use these statistical and biological properties to be able to infer the 3D, infer the way branches are in 3D around the trunk, add more branches in 3D, and also propagate to the neighboring parts of the tree. So you see here that in a few minutes you have a tree that respects the sketch and is really in 3D. So this was a collaboration with biologists from CIRAD in Montpellier. an example of copy-paste, I've chosen to talk about copy-paste with anatomy again. So here, you have a virtual human. You have captured it on a using scanner on a real human. But maybe you want to have some organs inside the more fancy characters on a variety of different humans. How can we do it? We model, in fact, rules from anatomy, saying that, okay, bones need to remain straight, fat, muscles should be proportional to fat, bones should not be proportional to fat, and we have an algorithm again to we erode fat, we register the skins together, here we want to transfer to Bart Simpson, and we will transfer first the bones, and then we will transfer the organs in between the skin and the bones, and we can model such anatomical model. So this can be used for entertainment. Of course, for movies, you need very precise models of the internal anatomy if you zoom on a virtual character. But it can be also used, for instance, for education. We are working also for medical education. This can be also very interesting. So this is a kind of movie we do when we present our result in a conference. So you see, it's also fun. And I particularly like this one. And lastly, sculpting. Okay, I have shown we can sculpt clay. Could we sculpt more structured, complex shapes? Can we sculpt a castle as if it was clay? It needs to remain a castle while we pull and stretch it. Here is an example of man-made object with self-similarities and local symmetries. A castle, in fact, is a kind of puzzle shape model with a puzzle grammar. This means that you can cut it into pieces and replace some pieces, insert more pieces, replace some pieces by others. And we take this into, we benefit from this. This is my castle seen from the top. And you will see that when I will bend it, a part of the castle will automatically become a tower, while when it is straight, it is a wall. So this is what we call a mutable elastic model. This is like an elastic model like clay. But when we will deform it, we will have some mutation. Stretch walls will become corners. Other pieces appear, and so on. And this is now an example how people can sculpt this castle. So here you see they can really express their intent. They just gave an example of the basic shape they have. If they stretch a hole too much, a new tower will appear. If they bend it, they can also cut into pieces and they have the door appearing, and so on. So this is really bringing this concept of sketching, sculpting to more complex content. So now our work now is to try to apply this concept to motion as well as static shapes. So sculpting crowds, I don't have time to present this to you. Sculpting character animation, I'm not sure I have the time for the next video, but the idea is that if I want to animate a dragon, for instance, I will do a first gesture which will both model the shape and also model the trajectory. So you see both the shape is deformed and the trajectory is modeled from my gesture. And in a few gestures, you are able to animate and then progressively deform, progressively sculpt your animation. So it's time to conclude. So a new methodology emerge for expressive modeling. We have two design principles. We want to enable seamless creation through gesture, sketching, sculpting, and so on. And for this, we need to embed knowledge in the models. So we are revisiting 3D models from a user-centered perspective. The user do their gesture, and we are thinking which knowledge should we put in the model so that they react in the expected way to the gesture we are doing. And my vision is that the future of this field will be a kind of magic pen where you can do course creation through sketching, then you can transfer what you have created by copy-pasting on something else, and then you can further edit through sculpting. And in conclusion, I hope I have convinced you that expressive creation in 3D is something really important. It's important for art and games, of course, but it's also a great tool for science because it can enable you to express what you have in mind, what you imagine. And with these tools, you can draw, freehand, and manipulate virtual 3D shapes. But you can also print them or fabricate them, as the two examples on the right, which are a 3D print and the fabrication of our little boot model, for instance. And you can, of course, also put them into an imaginary 3D world that you can explore for virtual reality, for instance. Thank you for your attention.